7 o'clock, close enough. First thing I want to do is, we've got minutes, which are not, it's not on here, it was supposed to be on there. Minutes for the July 14th meeting, if everyone take a look at it, if you've got any questions.
That's so long ago, I forgot about them. I'll make a motion and pass them, I'll write them back down.
Is that a second?
Yes.
Moved and seconded? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Abstained.
Abstained.
Wasn't here.
Two abstentions. We also need to, Mary tells me, we also need to elect a clerk. Ralph, no longer with us, no longer a member of the board, I'm sorry. Any volunteers?
I think Mary does a great job.
Oh, thanks, Derek.
That's a vote of support for you.
I've been doing this for a long time.
Are you willing to continue?
Do I have a choice?
Probably not.
Yeah, right.
You could elect somebody else.
Right.
Why, do you want to come to these meetings?
What happened, did you speak up or not?
Okay, all those in favor, Mary Stokarski is the clerk?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Is that unanimous?
Yeah.
Or is there one abstention?
No, one no.
One no.
Okay. Representatives of the Library Building Committee, or Library, whatever you want to call it, are here, and we've asked them to come and talk to us about the project. So I will, why don't we go around, and we'll introduce the people that are on the committee, and then you folks can tell us who everyone is. Well, Jack?
My name is John Pachurik, I'm on the Finance Committee.
Bruce?
Bruce St. Peters, Finance Committee, and Sewer Study Committee.
Bruce Hunter, Finance Committee.
Skip Olmstead, Finance Committee.
Mary Stokarski, Finance Committee, and representative to the Personnel Board.
Jeff Upton, Finance Committee, Sewer Study Rate Committee, and what was the other committee?
Capital
Planning Committee.
John?
John Pereski, Finance Committee, Sewer Study Committee, Capital Improvement Planning Committee.
Okay.
You sure you don't want to be clerk, John?
I'm going to start over here.
Yeah, hi, I'm Grant Vialli. I'm on the Library Board of Trustees, and I'm the Tilton Fund Treasurer.
My name is Judy Holmes. I am the president of Friends of the Tilton Library, and I'm also co-chair of the, our official name is Ad Hoc Needs Assessment and Planning Committee.
I'm Sarah Woodbury, Library Director.
And I'm Nancy Maynard. I'm the chair of the Board of Trustees. And so we're pleased to be able to...
Sharon, trustee of the library.
Brenda?
Brenda Hill, Town Accountant.
And
Joe from FCAT.
All right. So we're really pleased to be able to come tonight. We wanted to come and, you know, give you an update of where we are. You know, a lot has happened since the special town meeting in June, and we're preparing to send in our final report for the building project. And then we're looking forward to moving forward on the application for the next part of it, which is due the end of January. So we wanted to really be able to sort of, you know, give you some of the statuses of where we are, field any questions that you might have. We feel it's really important. We're making our rounds to lots of different committees mm-hmm. to be able to share information so that, you know, we feel that, you know, we've adequately educated different members of our community, as well as community presentations. So I'll let Judy start.
Thank you. I was just going to take a couple minutes to talk a little bit about our process so far, particularly how we went about assessing the needs of the town in regards to the library and library services. so that you can get a sense of where, how we came up with the project that we are presenting, that we're supporting. This sort of iteration of the addition to a library, the most recent one, started back in April of 2014 at town meeting, when town meeting voted to support to support a feasibility study and examination of expanding and renovating the library, and also voted to accept any monies from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners for that planning process. We did get a grant from them, from the MBLC, $40,000 grant, which was matched by a $20,000 gift from the trustees, the Board of Trustees. So we've had $60,000 to work with so far. And our planning committee was set up by September of 2014, it's officially a committee of the Board of Trustees, but we were also appointed by the Select Board. So the Select Board actually appointed us and swore us in and sent us on our way. What the committee tried to do, the first thing we tried to do was to educate ourselves about libraries and what their needs were. We visited at least a dozen libraries around Western Mass that had either had new additions built on them or were completely new libraries, including Sunderland, just over the river, to get a sense of what modern libraries were like and what kinds of services they provided. The Tilton Library was built 100 years ago, when the town population was, I believe, around 2,000 people. It's not designed to meet the needs of what a modern library is. The first thing the committee understood right off the bat was we just didn't have enough space. We didn't have enough space to be able to do the kinds of things that modern libraries, that residents expect their modern libraries to be able to do. There's no dedicated meeting room, there's no space for the teenagers, there's no more shelf space. Every time Sarah puts a new book on the shelf, she's got to take one off the shelf. There's no ability to have programming that isn't on top of the general services that general patrons are using. So anytime anything happens in the library, everyone's on top of each other. It's just not enough space. We also, in the election in November of 2014, we conducted a survey as people were coming in and out to vote to find out, try to get as broad a sampling as we could of the town population and what people thought of the library and what they wanted to see from it. We got those results. They were overwhelmingly positive. We also talked with library patrons about their usage of the library and what they expected. One of the things we kept hearing over and over again is that, well, I go to other libraries because Tilton Library doesn't meet my needs. So I go across the bridge to Sunderland, or I go to Greenfield, or I go somewhere else. Based on all of the information that we gathered, trying to examine what the library was doing and what other libraries were doing, what we could do if we had more space, we created a building program, which was submitted to the Mass Board of Library Commissioners in February of 2015. And the building program, which is on our website, you know, goes space by space, need by need, for what we're suggesting that a modern library would require. It's very detailed with the number of seats, the square footage, and the number of the sort of usage that the particular space was needed for. So based on the library program, in the summer of 2015, we hired an OPM and a designer, Johnson Roberts, to work with us. And in the fall of 2015, we got to work on coming up with a schematic design of what a library would look like, or what an addition on our old library would look like that would meet the needs as we had assessed them and are presented in this document.
Judy, is one of those documents available to somebody coming into town hall?
It's available on our website for sure.
Okay.
I don't know if it's
there is a copy in.
Okay.
In the Tilton Library website, there's a link to the building program. building project, and if you go to that project, there's this document as well as some schematic designs and other documents. There's a bunch of different things that are available on the website. After we had worked for about, I don't know, five, six months with the architect, we had come up at that point with a schematic design that we were satisfied with. And in February of 2016, we held our first open community meeting to present the design, to get feedback from people, and to see what people thought of it at that point. We advertised about the meeting. It was well attended, but it was held in the library, so the space was a little crowded. We also, at last April, at the town meeting, we had a table and leaflets. We had a second community meeting on June 1st. Again, to present the schematic design, and that was also in preparation for the special town meeting in June, which was when we asked for permission to go ahead with applying for a grant from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners. So let me just talk a little bit about the grant process and the budget as we've come up with it. The MBLC will be funding about 50% of this of the building costs. And we've worked very closely with them to make sure that what we've designed meets their requirements. And so we feel pretty confident that we're going to get a grant. We've crossed all our T's and dotted all our I's and done the things that we need to do. Although it's a lot of work, and we haven't submitted the final application yet. That comes in January. Next July of 2017, we'll hear two things from the MBLC. First is whether or not we've gotten the grant, and the second thing is where in the funding cycle we'll be located, because they expect to roll this out over a period of 4 or 5 years. So not all of the libraries that get funded are going to be funded in the first year. They may be funded in the second year, or the third year, or the fourth year. So each library that's been approved gets a number, gets a ranking.
So when you say funded in the first year, what would be the first year?
The first year after we get notification from the MBLC that we've been granted, we've gotten the grant, then we have 6 months to go to the town and get the town's half of the money, or the town's portion of the money, because there's also a big capital campaign going on. So the town's portion will hopefully be less than half. It'll be half less whatever the capital campaign raises. So the capital campaign is already underway now, and as soon as we get notification that we've gotten the grant, then that can really go into full swing. So we have 6 months after that to get approval for the rest of the funding, either through the capital campaign or through town funding. So that would be at a special town meeting sometime between July and January, I think 6 months after July of 2018. So if we then get the town funding, then we would be starting sometime after that.
We raise a concern, I guess. Last January, the school building committee, or the roof committee, mm-hmm. came to the town meeting and presented an article asking for $3 million, of mm-hmm. which the state, someplace along the way, would pay half. Mm-hmm. And once you get into those kinds of numbers, what we typically like to do, and what we did, was to vote to approve it subject to a debt exclusion. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to go into what a debt exclusion is mm-hmm. at the moment, but I would suspect that we would do something like that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That requires another town meeting mm-hmm. and vote. Mm-hmm. Is that a ballot?
It is a ballot.
It is a ballot. So.
Is it at a town meeting or is it an election?
It's at an election.
Yeah.
So that would also, I think, have to occur. Yep. So I just want you to be aware of that.
Okay. I thought mm-hmm. that was what happened. I thought that would be required too.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I just have a question. During the time of award in the 6 months, will the architect complete his design?
Yes. The schematic, as I understand it. I'm sort of learning all this as I go along. The schematic, if we get the grant, then we go back to almost to the drawing boards yeah. with the schematic that we have. and with the budget that they've come up with at that point too. So, I'm sorry, not the budget, but the projected cost if the schematic gets changed. But yes, what we've got so far is a working document, but everybody understands that it could be changed in the design phase.
Well, the reason my concern would be is that having an estimate based on schematic design, going to town meeting with that budget, very well might change the schematic design.
The footprint stays, the square footage stays the same.
Understood.
And the estimate's based on the square footage.
And the improvements inside, which hasn't been designed yet.
Well, it's
the heating system, that type of thing. Electrical costs, they're all been estimated.
Well, it hasn't been designed in the sense that there's a set of building plans, but, you know, we have this 35-page document which goes, you know, section by section by section by section of what's going to be required.
Okay.
So we've got that, and this is the overall budget, if you want to.
No, that's fine, that answers my question.
I'm sorry, what?
That answers my question. We'll be using the schematic design budget to go to town meeting with.
The budget that was presented, this one is May 26th of 2016, and so this could possibly, this would probably change somewhat if there are any other changes that are going to, like, for instance, I know that there's already been a reduction in the square footage from this budget that was prepared, because we had another meeting with the MBLC who wanted us to change a few things about the lobby, particularly so that we could fix some of the sight lines so that the people working would be able to see all around the space. And as a result of that, it reduced the lobby area by about 400 square feet. So this is off. This is estimating for about 400 square feet more than where we're at the moment.
Just what's the total square footage, the chair?
The total square footage is the current building. When you take the ADA thing off, which is going to come off, which would come off, is 3,600 square feet. The addition would be 91, and the total would be 12,700 square feet.
So 9,000 plus or minus square feet.
That's the addition, yes. But the original part is, of course, still being used too. So the total usage is is the margin. Could I have one? I gave that one away. Thank you. I'm sure that you all are much more familiar with reading these budgets than I am. If you want, I can just quickly walk you through this. It's a summary of everything. There's two columns. You'll see total and allowable. That's because the MBLC has certain things that they will not fund. So that's what the allowable is. It's allowable by the MBLC. And if you look down at the third line, the furniture, fixtures, and IT, that's one of the big things they don't fund. They don't fund furniture. They also don't fund things like paving. They don't fund moving costs. So the amount for the allowables is $7.1 million, and the total is $7.8 million. But the project cost, that $5 million up at the top, comes from this document, which was prepared by D.G. Jones International in Woburn, Massachusetts, the professional estimators. So you'll also see that the budget is carrying 4 years of escalation costs. So if we were to be granted, if we were to be in the first cycle, we wouldn't need all of those escalation costs. We might need just 1 year or 2 years of them. But these numbers are in 2016 dollars. The contingencies, project contingencies, obviously build that in if you need to have work order changes and whatnot. Plus, I've noticed that in this budget here, there's contingencies in every section of it. There's a contingency amount in every section of it. And you know, we would work as hard as we possibly could to make sure that we knew what we were doing when we submitted the final plans and that we didn't have to make those changes. And then in the second box, you'll see is how the MBLC grant calculation is made. They pay 60% of the first $3 million, 45% of the second $3 million, and 40% of the balance. The additional need factor is something that they rate each town sort of based on socioeconomic status. 6 is about a middle level number. If we were a wealthier community, we would get a less of an allowance there. And if we were a poorer community, we might get more of an allowance. And then we are expecting that this will be a LEED certified building. There are plans to put some solar panels on the roof, among other things, but the designers are very experienced in LEED certification. And so the MBLC gives you $100,000 as a sort of benefit if you meet their LEED certification. So the projected grant from the MBLC would be $3.9 million. And then when you subtract that from the total project cost, you get $3.9 million, which, as I said before, would be reduced by whatever the capital campaign raises, which we hope would be a substantial amount of money.
What's your goal?
So I could speak to that. Yes. Their capital campaign committee has just formed, and we have, at this point, 4 board members that are part of that. We've hired a fundraiser, and we're going to be looking over the next several months to add to that with community partners to join with that. And so we're just really starting to look at what that goal is and, you know, get some projections of what they think the community could, you know, reasonably raise. So we don't have a specific figure there, but you know, we're beginning to work at that, look at, you know, targeting goals, think about what that silent phase might be like. Okay. We're just getting that underway.
What are you using for heating fuel?
Oil.
Oil?
That's right.
Right now we have oil. We just got a new furnace a couple of years ago when Bernie was here.
Have you calculated what the increase in operating costs will be if this happens?
No.
That's one of the projects that we have to work on to estimate what that staffing would need to be, how that would progress.
Staffing, heat, power,
all those pieces.
Including health insurance, retirements, so on and so forth.
I would say about staffing, increase in staffing, we wouldn't ask for an increase in staff until we demonstrated the need for it, but I would also say that if there is a larger building, pretty likely that use and circulation will increase.
What was the name of the ad hoc committee?
The ad hoc needs assessment and planning committee.
Needs assessment?
Yeah.
And what?
Planning.
Oh. Needs. Thank you.
Assessment. The three terms, needs, comma, assessment, comma.
No, it was needs assessment. Needs assessing the needs and planning for the needs that you've assessed.
So roughly we're talking about $4 million coming through donations or taxpayer funded.
Yes.
Okay. Plus we have an operational budget that will obviously grow from where it is today. Correct.
I guess I'm not saying that as the operating officer, that we know that for sure. There are some libraries, and I don't think this is ideal, but there are some libraries that did not increase staff when their space was increased.
Right. Well, there'll be additional costs. I mean, you can't add 9,000 square feet to a 3,600 square foot building and not expect to have additional costs with operating.
Yes.
Even if it's a very green building, right, even if it's a very green building.
The custodian's going to have to spend more time.
I mean, everything, right, all the way.
And then, as an example.
Right, and would you be looking to extend hours also?
I think that what Sarah's suggesting is that until we could demonstrate that there was a need, that the town residents were wanting more hours and requiring more services, then we would come if we needed more staff time and say, here's what we've discovered since the new building has opened. You know, this is the way the usage has changed, and this is what people are wanting. So it would be when we can demonstrate that there's a need for more hours, that's when we would come to the town.
Right.
And typically, when we've done expanded hours over the years, you know, the Tilton Fund has funded a pilot to see. So when we added a morning to have more story time for young children. The Tilton Fund piloted that, and then we were able to bring that forward when we increased our budget the next year to demonstrate that need. And we've done that same when we added Fridays and when we added the Saturday.
My understanding is that the board, actually that building's owned by the Board of Trustees.
That's right,
yes. It's not owned by the town of Deerfield, correct?
Correct.
Yeah, okay.
Although the town of Deerfield has contributed to it.
Right, I know.
Contributes its operating costs and contributes to the initial building of the building as well.
Okay.
Back 100 years ago.
But the town owns the land.
No, the trustees own the land.
And also,
All right. How many cardholders do you have presently?
I don't know the exact number. I know it's 2,600 and something, which is a little bit more than 50% of town residents are.
Yeah, it's a little over 5,000 town residents right now.
Yeah, okay. So it's about, it's a little over 50% of those people. And there are people who use the library who aren't cardholders. You don't have to be a cardholder to walk through the door.
No, I was just,
probably vice versa too.
Right.
Cardholders that don't use it.
That's true, that's true. And some of the cardholders are children, of course.
Do you have any intention to applying for CPA money?
Yes, we'll apply for as much as we can possibly apply for in terms of the ability to offset.
Would that building qualify for CPA money, seeing how it's an addition? It's new construction.
I don't know. The original part does qualify for it. We'll be using the original part in
the exterior restoration of the outside of the building.
Right, on the original part.
Right,
but you still have 9,000 square feet to cover that wouldn't qualify for CPA.
Right. But on the behind where the ADA addition is the beautiful old facade, and the windows, the Norman windows are in the basement. So, you know, that's part of the project is to put those windows back in and restore it to its original, what it originally looked like. And the two, I don't know what you call them, arms that go out across the stairway have marble underneath them, which we'd like to restore that to. So those kinds of things. We talked to the historical commission.
Do you have a cost estimate on those type of things? I'm just wondering if you broke that out as far as what would qualify for restoration compared to new construction. As far as when and if you go and you know try to apply for CPA.
You know, that'd be something we'd need to work with our architects about. You know, to have them put that on their agenda to figure that out and to see if they could separate those out so that when we go to do these applications, we'll have the necessary data. I think for us, it's still kind of a step by step process.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. No, there's a lot to it.
Yes.
While the building is under construction, you plan to relocate the library?
Yes.
Has your place been chosen?
Or we're required to relocate and keep the library open.
Keep the library open. So you've included those moving costs, lease costs, back costs?
Those are in the other here. Testing, PVC, moving expenses.
And leasing?
Yes.
You have to lease.
Yep.
And do you know how long the construction will last?
I think we're talking about a year.
It happened. I've been told it happened very quickly. A year is pretty quickly.
Depends on the size.
Yeah.
It also depends. I might not be saying that if I'm in a smaller building, no windows or something.
But that is one of the projects that we're also working on to, you know, contact moving companies, realtors, you know, get a sense. But it's hard to be able to project that because we don't know where we are in the scheme of. Timeline,
you know,
so we can get a sense of what it will be square footage wise.
$100,000 or
$50,000. See, next July when we find out what our number is, where we're ranked, it could be that they're not going to give us this money for 3 years after that. So, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm.
But they could give it to
that year. They could give it to us that year, right?
So.
Right. And obviously, we would be hoping for the first. Oh,
understood.
Yeah, and because then the costs are less.
Yes.
Yeah. And that also changes, you know, this 800,000 figure that's in here is the 4 years of 20% escalation.
Well,
so it wouldn't be part of the final cost if we're going out in the first year.
It's also about 35 libraries at least in the whole state that are applying for this grant, and about 8 to 10 will be funded the first year.
So the chances are like 1 out of 4.
Given the need to go back and forth with town meeting, and if you're actually talking about needing to have this whole process approved by the town by January 1, I guess, what you're saying?
Well, it's 6 months after we have 6 months after they notify us. So if it's July 15th, then I guess it'll be July.
January 15th.
And we also could get it, there have been extensions granted for that period of time. I'm not sure how long it is, but.
Yeah, I'm not sure whether you'd be able to get that, all of that work done in 6 months or less.
6 months.
You always have the possibility that somewhere along the way, and you've got holidays coming up to November, December, January.
When the issue is, too, we've discussed in the past that special town meetings should not be warning articles.
Yeah, we are very much trying not to have special town meetings that spend any significant amount of money.
Mm-hmm. Because you don't get enough people out.
Yeah.
And I think if we were to go back to the MBLC and say, this is specifically what our town is trying to do, this is why we need an extension for this amount of time, you know, they seem to be very willing to listen and, you know, to adapt to the processes that we all have to deal with.
Well, certainly a question we can ask them now as well.
That would also extend your time for capital.
That's right,
fundraising, too.
Exactly, yeah.
If you narrow that down too much, you're going to, you know, create kind of a feeling that maybe more should have been done on fundraising. Mm-hmm. You know, so this would give you an opportunity to extend that out. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And CPA only does it an annual time meeting, right?
Oh, okay.
And that part is including in the construction, the anticipated cost for restoring that, that's in the, included in the construction costs.
Yes.
Tearing down the.
Yes, tearing down the.
It's in that 30 page.
Yes.
That's what you have.
Yes, this one here.
All the numbers are there.
Yeah, all the numbers are there.
I understand, you know, I guess I'm still struggling a little bit with the community room, and I understand the grant restrictions and that. Unfortunately, they come into play, but I still struggle with not being able to provide access to one of our biggest populations when we're doing this and not creating a multi-purpose building. And that's, once again, I'll bring up with the seniors, with where they're locating that at some point in time. I think their needs at some point in time needs to be addressed also. So we're kind of up against it financially,
yeah,
in this town,
yeah,
especially when people hear that they're going to be, could possibly be facing a $32 million sewer fix, besides a $4 million library and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. I mean, the list goes on. There's quite a few needs here. So, but I do want to say that I acknowledge the work that a lot of people have put in. It has been a long, long process, and. But I think we'll just have to see how this plays out.
You know, just one point about seniors is that, as with all of the different sectors of the population, of course, you know, they can use the library. And we
Correct.
Could have special programming for seniors. You know, we could have computer classes. You know, we could have people come in and help people learn how to work their phones. I mean, there's all sorts of things that we could do, special programming that would target seniors or anybody else who wanted to come in and take that, or you know, particular times of day when seniors could use the library. And then the new library will have an elevator, a real elevator, so that you don't have to go up on this creaky old, like, sort of thing from the past to get from the ground floor up to the... Up to the main entrance, so would have a real elevator. Would be, I think, much more.
Well, obviously, and I understand. And obviously, libraries right now, the focus is to recreate themselves more to a community center in what they can provide, because a library standing on its own is getting to the point where it could be struggling a little bit with today's technology. So I do understand that.
Okay. Any other questions? We do need to
one quick question. Okay. Is there any been any discussion as to is that community room going to be free to the public, or has there been a discussion of renting it out to various to kind of offset some of the operating costs, or
we haven't really gotten to that point yet. Certainly, any community group, whatever senior group or whatever, would use it without any cost. The way the building is designed is that the large meeting room, the main lobby gets closed off, and so the large meeting room can be used at times when the rest of the library is closed. It can be used at night. It's got two of the bathrooms in it. The current library has one bathroom in it, and the new library I think will have four bathrooms in it, and the kids' bathroom. I'm sorry I didn't bring the plans with me, but the larger meeting room is on the parking lot side of the building, and it's got a lobby. You can come into the main lobby, and the rest of the building is all closed off, so that that room can be used when the library is not.
Right.
I just want to answer that question. I think it's a really good good question. I've been looking in the old town reports, and the original library had a meeting room held 125 people, and the library trustees at the time did charge, and they had some small amount of income from it. My understanding is that once we get this meeting room, then the trustees would determine, probably usage and whether or not they would charge admission. But generally, Judy's correct that the idea is that it's a place where you could meet there. You would,
especially for Deerfield residents.
The town committees could meet there. Programs could be held there after the library is open.
So what about civic organizations like
the Women's Club, Lions?
Women's Club typically were one of the first users of the Tilton.
Are you thinking that they will be able to use this room?
Oh, yeah. I am, but again, I'm saying that would be something that the trustees would have a policy about who could use it, because you have to be able to allow everybody who wants. You can't say, oh, this person can use it because we like you, or that, we have to have a fair.
Right. We think your idea is more than this person. Right.
I think that, that we see this building as a resource for the whole town, for all sectors in the town. It's one of the reasons why, we feel like we really want our library to be able to provide space for teens, because there's no space in the current library for that age group. And we, this is a resource for the whole town.
Yeah, but I agree with what you're saying, but at the same time, with what was just said, it sounds like it's left in control of the Board of Trustees.
Well,
we're asking the town taxpayers $4 million or thereabouts, whatever the fundraising offsets, and yet at the same time, Deerfield pretty much doesn't have a say. It comes down to the Board of Trustees.
Well,
I realize that they will, get some consensus and so on and so forth, but it's no guarantee.
Some of the trustees are permanent and some of them are elected officials. And as we've done with all of the components of this project, we've solicited input, and we would do that as we're looking at major decision points that we need to do so that we can take that into consideration. And we would welcome that input.
Yeah, but your point is well taken. Of course, with representative government, no guarantees.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. That's what it comes down to. Right.
Yeah. Any other questions?
How many meeting rooms do you need in the town? You have meeting rooms at Frontier.
Okay.
You have meeting rooms at the elementary school. You have meeting room at the fire station.
If they let you use it.
The meeting room, the large.
Because this room out here that the library uses, mm-hmm. for the book sale.
Yes, we do.
So that's a
currently,
meeting room.
Currently.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The problem is that you get a lot of redundancy built in. Mm-hmm. And the question is, how much redundancy do you want when you're trying to balance out a $4 million budget? Mm-hmm. Now, if you got somebody to pay $2 million, that's great. But I don't think you're going to get that. Mm-hmm. I don't think there are that many people in town that are that generous. Mm-hmm. The most generous person that we had in town was Mike Kittredge before. Mm-hmm. And he would turn around and buy a new cruiser, put it down, because we never had a four-wheel drive cruiser, so he would turn around and just sponsor and say, here's a check for $35,000, go buy a cruiser. But I haven't seen anybody like him since that. And that's been 15, 20 years now. And I don't see anybody else in town that would be willing or able to step up to the plate. We had complaints because at one time we turned around and put Yankee Candle on the side of the ambulance. And somebody said, well, what'd you do that for? He says, because you gave us $35,000. You want to give us $35,000, we'll put your name on there. You know, we're not prejudiced. But the major donors should get some little bit of recognition for what they've done.
I think we've discussed that too, haven't we?
The fundraising committee is discussing options for that. Yeah. Naming rights to areas in the building.
Your name on the building, come up with $1 million.
Yeah, right.
At this stage, there's still a lot of questions. We're trying to get as many answers as we can, try to figure out what people's questions are. And when it comes down to a vote, we'll have a lot more of those answers. We'll know how much money we've got in the capital.
And these questions are input. We're not trying to put you on the spot.
No, exactly.
Right.
These questions are input. Right, right. We don't expect you to,
And we projected some of these questions we will be asking
later on.
Right, right.
And we will expect answers later on.
Right. And that's why we want to come to all the different committees, because we want your input. We want to know, what are the areas that you're looking at from a different vantage point, so that we can think about how we're going to address those. And the trustees are working very hard to do that. We feel good that, we're able to do that, because, the town is stretched with staff to do these types of projects.
I would hope that if they haven't already, talked to the capital improvement.
They're on the agenda.
They get to hear it again, John.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, would you like to make some final comments before we bring this to a close?
We're just appreciative of being able to come and take up a portion of your
Well, we thank
time
you for bringing us up to date on where the project stands.
And your time is valuable.
And we thank you very much for putting us at the front of the agenda.
You were here. And we've got other things that we've got to cover. There's no reason to make you wait until after we've gone through all of them.
Thank you very much.
And if anybody has any questions, you can call the library. Our phone number's been the same since 1955.
4683.
4683. So give me a call. If I don't know the answer, I'll write it down and we'll see if we can come up with it.
And we're going back to the selectmen on a regular basis as next stages of the project. So trying to keep everybody abreast of where we are and the changes that have happened.
Do you have any of those books that you can give out to people?
Well,
you have a lot of documents
here,
but I haven't seen one yet. And when it comes time to a computer, I'm not going to go out there and burn up my printer trying to burn copies of it.
If you want
to get people to support you, you have to provide information.
Okay. Didn't you have some of those in black and white at that special town?
Hey, John.
Not
you can have a town doing 20 cents a page.
You know that. And that's what they tried to do to give me the finance committee handbook. By the time they got through, they wanted $38 for
that was over a smart
get a finance committee handbook, which I do for free.
Okay, so we will work on that. John, I extend an invitation to come to the library. We've got the drawings there. We've got all these documents there. We've got nice places.
I would be glad to look at the documents, but I'd like to look at a lot of this stuff first.
Yeah.
Because whatever I get, I read.
Okay.
And I study.
Yeah.
And I try and anticipate what the problems are.
Uh-huh.
But it's going to be tough, just to make sure you understand. It's not going to be easy.
Right, we know that.
Turn around and had people fight over a $3 million roof that was an absolute necessity, and people didn't want to support it.
Right.
And here we are, $4 million for something that, it's nice, but it's not a necessity yet. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See you next week.
Yes.
Brenda.
Yes.
First thing I'm going to pass around is the free cash.
Did I print enough?
Yeah.
Okay. I figured I did.
Thank you.
Thanks.
this is not the free cash calculation. This is not the actual calculation that DOR uses to come up with our free cash, but it's kind of like the back doorway of being able to show you how it fits together and what pieces make it up. So it's not exact, but pretty close.
You're just trying to show us how we got there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was that, Mary?
Pretty close, higher or lower? Or?
Well, it came. Well, this little calculation came to $1,560,000, but the actual certified free cash is the bottom number, which is the $1,585,000.
What? Should that say free cash balance 6/30/15?
No, that is what we left on the table at the end of June of this year.
Okay.
So on July
15.
So yep. Yeah, so on okay. July 1.
Okay.
Then you it gets recalculated.
Yeah.
So we spent all of the free cash from last year except for
$475,000.
Okay.
That was what we left. And for those of you that were here in September when Terry Williams came and talked about local receipts, you always want to budget low on your local receipts so that you do have excess revenues mm-hmm. over estimated. You don't want to be caught in the other direction. I was looking at it earlier today, and I think a lot of the excess comes from, at least in fiscal year 16, a lot of our excess came from excise taxes, motor vehicle excise taxes.
That usually just ends up being a higher number than they estimate every year.
And we actually had $100,000 more in rooms and meals tax than what we had budgeted. So those two are probably the two biggest things that make up that difference. And then as far as the unencumbered, unexpended appropriation balances, I did not go through and look at those in any detail, but we've got that information here tonight, so if you want to go through some of those, we certainly can.
It is one of the things, and I haven't made a whole lot of progress with the selectmen on that, but if you think about the fact that the budget that we've got, call it $1.5 million for or $15 million for discussion purposes, of which, give or take, $10 million goes to the schools, and I guess we might have gotten $40,000 or $50,000 back from the schools.
We actually didn't get anything back from the schools because they did encumber all of that.
Okay.
Every penny.
So we did nothing
there.
So
they don't get anything back.
They did a couple of years, but not very much, yeah.
We used to.
I went back and looked.
So you can give them $25,000, which is what? I was on the school committee.
Yeah, we turned around and gave them money to build a new roundabout out there on the side of the school.
Yeah.
Which was never forecast initially.
Yeah. So we've got a budget of roughly $5 million that is the town side. And the excess unencumbered, unexpended, appropriated balance, we're getting $500,000 back. Give or take, about 10%, or we tend to be over budgeting by about 10%. Better that we're over budgeting than under budgeting, but I'm wondering if somewhere along the way it wouldn't be possible to kind of squeeze that a little bit. Departments would still have the money they need to spend, but we wouldn't have to, appropriate an additional $500,000 over and above what's actually needed.
Where would they get the money they need to spend? I guess they keep asking for it, not spending it.
Well,
right?
That's what they're doing. They're asking for $5 million and they're spending $4.5 million. Good. I mean, I don't, there's no need to spend more, but could we be a little tighter with the budgeting instead of ending up with a $500,000 surplus? Maybe 200,000. I don't know. It seemed that we ought to be able to budget a little closer.
Well, the surplus comes from something that's unexpected, like the meals and room tax.
No, I'm talking about this.
No, now we're talking about expenses.
Third number down, $517,000. That's straight from the budget, leftover.
We had no transfers this year on what?
Well, we did have some, but.
At the end.
At the end, but it was by department anyway, so.
We put $25,000 to schools. I think of the total we had, the $80,000, we ended up going approximately, it's in there.
I think we only had $9,000 left of it.
Yeah.
I was just looking, just real quick and dirty, out of district placement, of course, we budgeted for, I believe, 3 students to be attending school, and I think in the end, we ended up with nobody at the very end. So we saved $48,000 there, and that's something you can't predict. You have to budget for what you think is gonna happen there, but.
School lunch was real bad.
I think the transfer station had some extra money. Possibly because the well maintenance, the well maintenance might not have happened like it was supposed to, or they get billed for it or something, I don't know.
I'm the new guy on the block, but maybe as we look at each department's budget, we should then, at that same time, look how they did the last year.
The last couple of years, probably.
Do it department by department.
My line item.
There's also another way, a possibility, it'd be a little more work for us in the long run, but looking at the budgets, trimming them down, and putting more in reserve so that if there is an issue, we're still gonna cover it.
So here's another thing that you could never predict. We have to budget according to what the state tells us the cherry sheets are gonna give us. And they left $58,000 on the table because we weren't charged what they thought we were gonna be charged for the charter schools. But then again, we didn't get the income that they were intending for us to have from the charter schools either.
That's correct.
So, let's see what else. And I know, because I work closely with Barbara, I know it's really hard to pinpoint group insurance, unemployment insurance, those kinds of things. You go with
right.
to a certain extent, well, right. You go with the information you have at the time, mm-hmm. thinking that's going to be pretty accurate, and things can always change. Like, I know with the unemployment, we knew that some teachers were going to be laid off, and we were expecting them to file for unemployment, but every one of them got a job.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we didn't end up spending that amount for the unemployment insurance. So there's things like that.
Are we gonna pay as you go for unemployment, as opposed to paying 3% of the wages every year?
Yes, we're gonna
pay as you go.
We pay it.
Doesn't go to the fund.
No. I just passed out the local receipts.
The estimates,
and the actuals for. Mm-hmm. So you've got several years of mm-hmm. actuals versus estimates, and then the 2017 estimate and suggested estimate for 2018.
And these are obviously just thrown out there for you to play with. I threw some numbers down knowing somewhat of the trends, not necessarily going by the 80% average or the 85% of the 5-year average. Like for instance, the interest on taxes. If you look at the third line down, I budgeted low for that, and the reason I budgeted low for that is that Barbara is collecting the taxes a little bit differently, so we're not collecting as much in interest as we had been. So I'm budgeting a little bit lower because I'm seeing that trend going down.
Mm-hmm.
What does line 10 mean?
Pardon?
What is line 10 for, please?
That would be, good question.
So
when we closed the peg access.
Before you go any further, let me pass this one out too, because this has all the
Yes, it has all the detail.
Okay.
So when we close the PEG access fund this spring, it's now going to be in the general fund.
So
$80,000 comes in from PEG access, of course, of which we spend almost the entire amount.
This breaks down each one of those line items.
Yes, it does. Okay, so your fees are the delinquent INEs, the assessors, the collector, registry markings, town clerk, the police, any of the fees that the police collect, health board for septic, health board other, canine control. So you've got all of those. If you look on your second page, on your backside, there you go. There's your fees.
We're still up to $10,000 on the INE delinquent charges. So.
Yeah. I know, I was looking at that going, wow, that's a lot.
What is that?
So if we added up the estimated
common expense reports of anybody with personal property supposed
$50,000?
What's that?
If we added up the estimated column and the detail, it would say $50,000.
No, because we don't budget in detail. We just budget on the gross.
No. But I'm looking at
Brenda's detail. We do budget the gross, and I break it out for a
right. I'm just
I think.
Yeah. But would it add up? Does it add up to 50? That's all.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to see what other numbers.
Yes, it would add up to 50 because I reconcile those numbers.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You actually did break it out then.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, I do that personally. Just I throw some numbers in there based on what I saw from last year.
Any questions on this so far? Is this useful information?
The other change I made on line 17. We also closed the one of the revolving funds that did not get renewed was for plumbing, gas, and wire. So all inspections now are being done through the general fund, and all expenses for that are also in the general fund. So Doug took an average, I think, of the last 5 years of plumbing, gas, and wire income and used that as an estimate for our increase to licenses and permits, and I just included that then in the 5-year average.
That's the licenses and permits on 17.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. I think that one might be a little high.
It very well could be. I thought it was pretty high for the 2017 estimate. Mm-hmm. It was $215,000. So I brought it down a little bit, but it could still be a little high. One of the things, line 22 is new, Medicaid reimbursement. I think that's been on the recap for the last couple of years, but I just realized it this year, so I've now added it as a line item and plugged in a little figure for it. I don't know, you can see they're kind of all over the board, $41,000, $50,000, $32,000, $61,000 for actuals. So I just plugged in $25,000, not knowing what we could expect for fiscal 17, just a lowball figure to get us going.
Yeah, sure.
Or for fiscal 18. What's that?
That reimbursement's for the kids at the elementary school? Is that what it's for?
I don't even know.
You included 2012 in the average, right?
Yes.
Which is zero.
For?
Which would bring it way down.
Oh, for the Medicaid reimbursement. Yeah. Oh, that's a good point, yes. And is it because I didn't go back that far? It could be that I didn't go back that far to get that number.
No, it's probably in the spreadsheet calculation.
Mm-hmm, correct, it is, right, yeah.
Brenda, where does the, the fee that we end up charging South County EMS for the services that your office and Barbara's office provides?
Well, it's not actually a fee. Indirect costs are just a pass-through, so it's actually just a transfer of cash from them to us.
Do we budget that someplace?
It is considered a funding source.
Mm-hmm.
in our omnibus budget.
So we put our budget together, we should have a...
So it doesn't show up in local receipts, it doesn't go there?
Is it credit against expenditures?
Well, not even that, it's just a transfer of cash, because you're expending the money in the general fund. Okay, so you can't expend it also, that same money in the enterprise fund. So the only way the DOR will allow us to do it is to just transfer cash.
So not an offset?
So it reduces our taxes.
Okay, and so it's a bottom line.
Correct, but it doesn't show up in income, and it doesn't show, it's just a transfer. You'll see it on the detail. On the detail, on the last page, transfers from other funds. But that's the only place it's going to show up. There's your transfer from the enterprise fund.
57,227.
57,899 from the enterprise fund.
That's scams. That's all scams.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Yes, that is our only enterprise fund, so that's, yes.
So that number is supposed to be adjusted annually.
It didn't for this year. I don't know why, but you're right. We were talking about that today because Terry Williams wants to see that number change.
I understood. I agree.
Yeah.
It's based on it's whatever charges there were, 10% of the charges that...
I'm not sure what that...
I have a copy of the...
Do you? Because I know I do somewhere, but Casey and Doug came up with that calculation,
yep.
And then of course she met with the town administrators, and they agreed on a formula.
Yep.
But who's in control of that, I guess I don't know.
I don't know either.
I think Deerfield's supposed to develop that figure.
Yes.
Or pass it off to the SCEMS board.
Yes.
And the SCEMS board is supposed to appropriate that money.
Correct.
Put it in their line item budget, yes.
Yeah, in their line item budget.
Yeah, makes sense.
But the thought, I'm not sure I have the calculation.
Okay.
I know I have the agreement that they proposed. And the 10% and there was something else in the agreement.
Yeah, it's 10% of something, but I don't know
but
what
it's
that.
Multiple salaries and it's a whole bunch of things.
I'm sure it would include Barbara and Sarah and me and the town administrator. I'm not sure who else. And of course, then it also includes the software, a few other things like that.
Yeah, and Zach's office space and heating, lighting, a percentage of that. So, right. But I don't know. I don't know where to find it.
I think Wendy had a copy of that, or maybe Carolyn did this evening. I know we were kind of talking about it, and I thought Wendy was going to pull it out, but.
Okay. So this chart is local receipts. Is that what you call it?
Yes.
Okay. I have to catch up.
I think everybody has.
That's okay.
Sure.
Ask as many questions as you need to.
What is the special revenue funds?
So the special in that case, I'm trying to remember what that 70,000 was.
Municipal building.
Is that what it was for the municipal building? $70,000. Maybe it was for FY16.
I think it was a combination.
What it actually ended up happening was we not only had that, but then we closed plumbing, gas, and wire, and we closed PEG access,
okay.
And that's why your actual is quite a bit higher.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So I understand why now there's a medical and town meeting warrant to eliminate the gas and wiring inspector.
Mm-hmm. Right.
By law.
Yeah.
I understand
that.
Oh, okay. That would make sense. I didn't look at any of that in any detail, but yeah.
And the one that I just passed out is the general fund for FY16.
Yeah, this is all the expenditures for the general fund for that year. That's your final numbers.
So you can see the unencumbered balances.
Yeah, the reserve fund, we only left $6,800 on the table.
Okay. This is how we came up with our free cash.
Well, this is part of where the... we ended up with $579,000 in
Right.
But you'll see there's some other things in here too.
If you go to the last page, page 9, your unencumbered balance actually shows 719,000.
Right.
But the reason it does is because some of those funds were continued, so you have some continuing appropriations. Like the generator for the school, the $27,000, or the $9,200 for their door hardware, or the assessors have GIS software of $16,000 that they wanted to carry forward with the idea that they were going to use it. The triennial recertification is carried forward. So there's different things that get carried forward. So when I removed all of those, what was left was $579,000.
And you also have $58,000 in the funds from the state assessment charges.
Correct, correct. That was what I was talking about earlier. Yeah.
And that's on page 7.
Yeah.
The top of page 8 there, charter schools, school choice.
Awesome. This summarizes a portion of the free cash.
Which ones get continued to be appropriated? The capital expenditures? Each
department has to tell me if they want to carry something forward, and they have to have a good reason to do so. And actually, it was a lot less this year than it was last year, so that was kind of nice to see.
And those would show up as encumbered funds, right, or not?
No, they show up as continuing appropriations.
Okay.
Is that how?
So that's up to you.
It's up to me, the town administrator, the department heads.
Ultimately,
the town administrator has to approve it.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the cases, don't they have to have a document saying they purchased this?
Well, that would be for the encumbered funds. For the continuing appropriation, it has to be, you know, we need this, and this is the reason why we need it. We're planning to use this, you know.
Is it a town meeting article also?
No.
When they go to do the budget for fiscal year 18, who's looking over their shoulder to make sure they don't double it up? That is, they don't ask for that money again? Do you know what I mean?
I you know what? That's a good question. It's kind of in the town administrator's ballpark, but they know what we've continued forward, so they would know if anything was doubled.
So
That's something we should know.
Can we get a list of the continued forward dollars in departments?
Is that's the care where you show carry forward, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, it's on that
okay.
side.
So this is
the first column.
That was carried forward from the previous
year. You'd have to look in this year's, which I also will give you.
Okay. Yeah. So it'll be a column for carry forward.
The first
column. Yes.
So this is my only copy right now, but just so you have an idea, this is what you can see, continuing appropriations, encumbered funds. So you'll see that by fund, the general fund, then you've got continuing appropriations for CPA monies, because those carry for 3 years. You'll have continuing appropriations for wastewater treatment plant, and then you've got your encumbered funds that the school has, and there's one other encumbered fund, I believe.
So wastewater treatment fund has a capital improvement fund?
They have several capital requests that continue to be carried forward.
This is something I report to the
OR every year.
Do you want a copy of that?
I would like a copy.
I'd have a copy of it.
All right.
Please. Do you want to make a copy or do you want me to?
No.
Thanks.
I think it would be helpful to keep at least one eye on it.
Mm-hmm.
We've been told there's no capital money at all, pretty much, other than
for the sewer. You're talking about the sewer.
Yeah. Bottom line is, we've always budgeted at least a year in advance, and we've always budgeted $600,000 or $700,000 for years.
For
sewer.
For the reserve fund.
In the reserve fund.
Right.
And what happens is, when they start using the sewer, they pay everybody out of that reserve fund that we have, and then they get a wallop of money in December and another one in June.
I do know for fiscal 16, we did not meet our expectations, but that was because the sewer information didn't come to the treasurer's office fast enough for them to get the bills out in time. So we've actually collected $135,000 worth of stuff that should have happened in fiscal 16. We've collected in fiscal 17, yeah.
Right. On this one here, didn't they turn back some of that to the general fund last year?
No, what's happening with the revaluation, the recert costs, is instead of funding it from free cash, they're funding it from their unencumbered balance.
Oh, okay.
So they just carried that forward this year so that we'd use $20,000 out of this, and next year we'll probably do the same.
Oh, okay.
So
okay,
that in fiscal 19, then they'll have to fund it through something else. Yeah, it was...
I thought they had turned a certain...
You got some papers in front of you, got to pass out.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm slowing up here.
I'm failing already.
First day on the job. You too.
Okay, so I'm going to check this. I said we'd kind of take a look at South County EMS. This is for FY 16. This is kind of a detail on the expenditures.
I think so.
Yeah, so this is 2014-15 actual, and then 2015-16, so fiscal 16 appropriated, and then 2016 expended. If you go to the last page, you'll see in fiscal 2015, the net difference was $502,000. So that is what went to retained earnings because that was their first full year of operations. Okay. And in
that's left over.
That was what was left over in that year. And then in fiscal year 2016, what they had left over was
$359,506. So as of
end
of June 30th of this year.
Pardon?
June 30th of this year.
And in that is 50, or there's an expenditure of $58,000, which is
our administrative fee.
The administrative fees.
For fiscal 16.
And also they voted to expend $300,000 for the ambulance a year early. Otherwise, we would have had $800,000 in there.
No.
Well, it was.
280.
It was budgeted for fiscal 17, so it had to come out of retained earnings before the end of the fiscal year.
It was budgeted for 18.
No, it's budgeted for 17.
Well, we originally had projected.
Projected budget was 18.
And they.
They've chosen as was voted in the town meeting in April. They voted to spend it in fiscal 17, which is really a good thing because they've had that thing towed how many times already this year at a huge cost. So it's time to get it replaced.
So the total is.
Oh, that's right. They're replacing Waitley.
They're keeping
that
one.
Yeah.
$862,000.
That's right.
Which is could be a disaster.
So what was that? What
it's $862,000 is the retained earnings, of which $280,000 will come out of that.
Plus some others. So actually they're using, they used of fiscal year 15, they used all but $100,000 of the retained earnings. So at the end of June of 2016, this last June, what's left in retained earnings is I think $517,000 because they're using some of that for this ambulance and for some additional expenses.
But we've already paid for the ambulance and those additional expenditures, and we still have $517,000.
Right, basically, yes. So hopefully they will do the same thing again this year and use some retained earnings so that it'll reduce the assessments.
Yeah, but they haven't looked at it that way. That's the issue. The issue is they said they're only going up $1 just because they knew Deerfield was going to whine. So the $1 Tom Fight and Kevitz put in and said, we're going to, he'll pay the dollar increase, so there'll be no increase for us. And the bottom line is, they're $500,000 over our rent. So, you know, they say one thing, but really, the fact of the matter is that they're over budgeting by $500,000 a year. That's what the issue is.
I missed the $517,000. I can't find
it. It's not in there. It's not there. That number is part of the free cash.
You're right. That's part of our free cash certification. Yeah, it was $517,405 was the certified.
That just added to the $359,000?
Nope, that's the net. That's what's left after they used some of it in fiscal 17. They've reserved some of it aside for fiscal 17. They've reserved $345,000.
We voted a budget of what, $1.1 million at town meeting?
Yeah.
Plus $300,000.
17,405.
Well, in other words, $1.4 million is the actual amount that they're going to, they tell us.
That they're going to spend.
Of that, $285,000 is for the ambulance.
And $1,129,000 or something was for the other expenses.
Standard budget.
Which includes the indirects.
Right.
Yeah.
Which we wouldn't have gotten if we didn't start making a lot of noise about it.
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute, that's all revenue.
Right.
$1,129,000.
And that equals your expenses. $1,129,000 is also your expenses. So it's a net of zero.
Where does it
I know
show
that report doesn't didn't reflect that column very well.
Brenda, where does it show what their income was?
If you look,
is this the one?
This is where they put it.
Medical services fees.
Yeah. If you look at the top, medical service fees, you'll see that they had budgeted $380,000 and they actually received $499,000, so almost $500,000.
And what they're carrying forward is what has
what do you paid? Carry forward? 3879.
Okay, let me pass this.
Forward, you can, is that what hasn't been paid yet? Because I know it's like a 9-month cycle or something like that.
Well, they don't have any carry forwards.
I know, but I'm just saying.
But you're, yeah.
Yeah, okay. It just says
so
unencumbered
like
balance.
The first 6 months of 16.
And it's the
is
first,
that amended on that column? This is
is
that the amended amount, or is that in addition to?
No, this is the one that I'm passing up now.
I don't
the
know
first
why
three
that's
months,
showing up
the
in the amended column. I can't
tell
you why that is.
Okay, so there's two.
There's the one that's got this red and yellow.
Yeah.
Moving on.
Ignore that one.
Moving on.
Ignore the amended.
Yo. First.
And I'd asked Brenda, we could have done away with a quarterly, but I wanted to get a quarterly just because it's easy to make the calculation.
This one.
Oh, okay.
Yours also. That came out before, the handout before.
Okay, right. So the one in pink is through the end of October. It's current, up to date, but it only reflects income through the end of September. Okay. And then the other one is just a quarterly report, as Skip said, because he wanted to see it just for the quarter, just to see what the difference was.
The quarterly one, it's a little easier when you take a look at, let's take call staff. They've expended roughly $30,000. They budget $167,000. Mm-hmm. 30 times 4 is 120. So unless they do something, they're looking at about a $40,000 to $50,000 balance in that account at the end of the year.
I'm picking up the date a little bit. They are short one person.
Mm-hmm.
And you probably watched the last meeting.
No.
So they're short one person. They're running a lot of overtime. Mm-hmm. That's shown up here also.
Mm-hmm.
So their call staff numbers are higher. They hope to hire somebody next month. They have at least four qualified candidates.
Oh, great.
And Carolyn suggested that they hire two people.
Well, they certainly have enough work for two more people.
Yeah.
And well, the problem is how much are they going out of the area?
Well, that's...
You know, the issue is that the town of Deerfield's paying for it, and yet they want to go to every other town around here and start providing a service for Franklin County. Well, guess what? The town of Deerfield's paying for it. They should stick to the original game plan, and they should say, this is what we have, this is what we want to service, that's what we're servicing.
But do they charge for their intercept fees?
Yeah, it's a fixed. $175?
Yeah, because I know North Hampton will charge us for intercept fees.
Yeah, $275, $300, something like that for intercept.
To me, it wasn't enough.
That's not.
I was going to say, what's it cost? It's going to cost more than that.
I mean, it's one thing if we're, you know...
So you're doing it for PR.
If we were working with, say, Greenfield, and Greenfield was coming down here as often as we were going up there.
That's a fair trade.
With Stillwater out, we may be using Greenfield a lot more.
That's a good point. Hopefully we'll get that fixed soon.
That's a big scare.
But I do think it's important that, and I made this comment before, I'll make it again, with EMS, the goal that they set and presented to all three towns was to provide paramedic service and reduce the times. They've met those goals. So why are we at a point now of talking about growing this in more coverage, more vehicles, or whatever the case may be, if that's coming down the pipe? Which means
what they call that?
Right.
Empire building.
Well, you know, I don't want to say that, but what I'm concerned about is if
they, like Trump. Right. It's like they got three ambulances, but now they want a $50,000 chase vehicle. Why do you need a chase vehicle if you already got three ambulances?
That doesn't make sense. Right. My concern is, before we start growing anything, let's get our arms wrapped around where we're at. They've accomplished some great things here, but let's slow down a little bit. You don't want to grow too fast. And if you're talking about any type of growth, as far as I'm concerned, your bottom line should not be changing. Your bottom line, if anything, should be decreasing. Your bottom line for the three towns should not be increasing. It should be an offset.
It should be a saving instead of down.
Exactly. If they, you know, so that's all I'm saying is hopefully we're a little cautious with the talk of growth. And I don't know exactly where that is coming from. So we all should be paying attention to that, that's all.
Well, the other thing is the comments were made with, is they'll investigate the cost after it's being done. There's absolutely no reason why a fiscal plan cannot be done prior to being involved in this.
That's our responsibility.
At least do some kind of projection. You know it's not going to be right on, but it'll give you some idea.
We are the fiscal rep for South County EMS.
But
we have to prepare that.
But their comment was they're going to look at after.
But that's wrong because
it's got so much money in a budget, they figure they can play with the money and experiment, and whatever they come up with, they'll say, well, that's what we planned on doing.
No, minutes.
No.
We voted on it, so we never done
minutes.
Well, I would think that would be Zach's position to be monitoring that on a regular basis and being able to recommend to the Board of Voters.
I think it shouldn't have to be monitored. It should be a plan proposed before.
Right.
And then monitor the plan to see how the plan is working.
Correct.
Okay, not expending first and then looking at it after. You should be able to get a pretty good handle on.
Okay.
Can I ask a couple more questions
about
this? Sure.
Yes.
Zach's salary went up $10,000. Is that. Was voted last selectman's meeting?
Well, I haven't come to personnel.
Well, oh yeah, I was going to say his.
Again?
Yeah.
I was going to say I was told that, but I have not seen anything on paper yet. Nothing's been approved, as far as I know.
I thought it was approved last meeting. You were last meeting.
They can approve all that, but they don't.
The Skims recommended it.
Right. And the Board of Selectmen?
They said it.
Right.
They voted it?
They recommended it to move it forward
as far as to Deerfield,
to the financial oversight.
But I thought you were going from Board of Selectmen meeting.
Would take him from 70,000 to 80,000 then, right?
No, they talked about it, but they could not take that step because the personnel board had.
That's what I wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
It was going in the other direction.
Huh?
Yeah. The other comment is vehicle maintenance. Looks like, is that because of the problems with the, our mainline vehicle?
Yes, correct.
What's your count, where is it?
This is 5603, no, all the same, but 5400. It's
207.
Yeah.
Something made.
So you'll see they've spent $10,600 already for a total year budget of 18.8.
Well, that was, most of it spent in October then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep, you're right.
$7,000.
So, but that's.
They've towed it a couple times.
But that's gonna be the main second.
Yeah, I just got the towing bill, and it's not in these numbers, because it'll be paid in the November warrant.
And then the other one is 403, employee benefits. We pay those ahead for some reason, or it looks like they're just out of whack.
Yeah, that does look way out of.
So what's included in the employee benefits is workers' comp.
Yeah.
And workers' comp is paid on July 1st.
So this is cash basis.
For the entire year.
Yep, for the entire year.
So that's why it's skewed.
Yep, exactly. And then, of course, you have Medicare, which gets put in there with every payroll.
Every quarter.
With every payroll, every time we do payroll.
Yeah, it comes out, but you know.
Oh, you're right, it's once a month.
Once a month you pay?
Yeah.
Then the billing, skim billing, is that, what is that? That's not.
That would be ComStar Services.
Okay.
The contracted out.
So the 50%, well, about that.
The only thing I can tell you on the vehicle maintenance, that's primarily the first line vehicle, which is the Navistar.
Yeah.
And they bought that brand new, whatever it was, 6-7 years ago, as did a whole bunch of other ambulance services around the at least Western Mass.
Yeah.
No one is buying them again.
Understood, but it's scheduled to be our backup, second vehicle.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, is that one better or someone better?
Somebody's gonna make.
Well, it's bigger, that's the only thing that I could tell you.
I think
it's gonna cost $10,000 a quarter to maintain it.
Equipment that they can use.
I don't know if we can afford that.
The newest stuff.
The professional training, 503, looks like they had some major training the first part of this year.
I know, I saw, yes, I remember seeing like a 15, I can't remember.
To bring the certification up, a yearly certification?
I can't remember for sure, but I know there was some education, and I thought it was an awfully high bill, but I, that was what they put through to pay, so.
Do we have anything in language that requires them, if the board is paying for their training in that, that they have to make commitment to the service for 2-3 years?
No.
Thereafter? So somebody could go through and the taxpayers could pay for training, and 6 months later, or 3 months later, or a year later,
it's happened.
They could turn around, walk away, and
to be honest,
they have all these certifications.
A lot of research.
Research, yeah, but whatever, they're obviously.
But we've lost a full-time employee about every 5 or 6 months.
Yes.
Yes.
So is that something that we should be looking into?
I mean, employee.
Financial.
I was gonna say we don't lose any.
Carol, right.
Carol. Our financial rep, we have to bring it to her.
Well, the other thing is just not that, but they also, I'm assuming, they get custom turnout gear as well.
Oh, yeah.
They do.
And what happens to that?
That's.
You know, even if it's turned back, it may or may not fit the next guy.
I was going to say, it all has, yeah, you're right. It has, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I would assume.
Good point.
As well as its size and everything else.
I'm sure. I'm sure it is.
And unfortunately.
Is that a line item?
I wonder what other towns do.
Yeah, uniforms and laundry.
Yeah.
I know
what the police department does in the town of Deerfield. There's usually a clawback in their contract. If you leave the department before 2 years after you complete your training, you have to pay back the training to go to be certified at the police academy.
That's a little right. Police academy is a lot larger. We're talking about some of these classes are only one day.
Yeah, but the other thing is, from what I gather, I don't know, do they ride for free for 6 months? It sounds like when they're, if they're just getting their certificate, that they've got to ride in the ambulance for 6 months before they can get certified. Are they riding with no charge to the town of Deerfield?
As long as it, no, as long as there's a paramedic there that's being paid is whatever they are.
So
they, most of these people that they're training, I do believe, are EMTs, and they're training them to become paramedics.
And from what,
and
what
with
was
paramedics, they have to ride as an EMT for a period of time.
Yeah, until they're proficient in each of the procedures they have to.
Mm-hmm. So they are working personnel in a period of time.
But they're not working at the
EMT
level.
EMT can drive.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, that's not.
Okay, so that's not an issue.
But they're being paid as a paramedic.
Well, if only if they are paramedics.
No, they are a paramedic, but they, to be able to function as a paramedic, they have to achieve a certain level of efficiency in each of the
hours.
And now it's more proficiency in each of the challenges that they might occur. So they have to, and Zach, I believe, is the one that makes that determination, whether they have reach that point.
So
we're paramedic trainer.
They have to be certified.
They're certified as a paramedic, but then after that they have to do a certain.
So 6 months of training,
right.
They're basically.
It could be 6 months, it could be 5 months, depending
right,
on what
right,
conditions
whatever.
They run up against. If they're able to use the
they should be able to do all of that if they're already a paramedic.
But they have to be, have to do it in front of another paramedic to be able to say yes. If the efficiency is there.
On the job training.
On the job training.
They have a lot of hours.
And then when they walk out the door, that's all gone.
Right. So they could get their efficiency level to the paramedic level in here, being paid as a paramedic, and move on to another job.
That's probably what they're doing.
Well, some of them have done that.
So, but just a few, I mean, most of the budget items are pretty consistent, I think. Except for the few that we discussed.
I think it was copied pretty much from last year.
Oh, no, no question. So that's why we end up with a similar excess.
Yeah, so errors are, you'd see the same error.
So they just don't take the time, sounds like they don't take the time to sit down and say, here's what we think
well,
it's going to be.
No,
it
they don't.
It sounds like they're taking the easy way out.
It was one, from what I understand, it was one person.
That's what it looks like.
It was not one of the employees.
Do you have any more questions on this?
No.
Well, I've got four copies of special town meeting for November 14th, which
I have a copy.
5 o'clock this afternoon, it was off. And I guess now they're talking about postponing. They voted to postpone it till either December 5th or January 9th.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Yeah.
I have a copy of the draft.
I have a copy of the draft.
Has it changed at all?
It has changed.
I think Wendy was working on some things yet today that.
But it, there are things in here that have
that,
to change,
yeah.
Article 12 is now Article 15, so there's three articles been added in front of that.
So if anybody wants this thing, I'm more than happy to pass what you can all fight over the course.
I printed one out and made comments.
And
we're not going to talk about it.
We'll get another one.
Good.
Skip, is there any reason for me to continue with you this evening?
Unless any more questions.
Anybody have any other financial kind of questions that I could answer? You're always welcome to stop by my office and talk, and I can give you more details if you need it.
Try not to do it lunchtime.
What's that?
Try not to do it at
lunchtime.
I did that the other day. You can be up in the lunchroom.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brenda.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thanks, Brenda.
All right, have a good night.
Yeah,
you too.
We'll try to review all the paper. Make sense of it.
I think it makes sense of it, but please.
No, I think it's a lot of things I just.
It's getting a little late, but I would like to meet again sometime or other in a few weeks, and we can maybe set a plan of action about how we're going to approach the budget for the year. And
one thing I'd like to ask is that we get the selectmen to do what they're supposed to do and put out the guidance that they're supposed to go out to all departments.
They have.
And I haven't seen it.
neither do I.
Okay. The thing is, that's supposed to be our charge to us, too.
Yes.
And the bottom line is, unless we know what they're thinking of or how they want to manage their departments, we don't know what they're looking at, and we're hanging out there doing what we figure we always do.
Is there sunlight?
It was emailed to us by Barb or Brenda.
Oh, I didn't get
Barbara.
I didn't get this.
Skip, how soon do you want me? A week, 2 weeks?
2 weeks would be fine.
Yeah, if you would.
Since we don't have that November 14th meeting.
Oh, never mind.
How about November 8th? Because we have a sewer rate committee meeting on November 15th.
November 8th.
November 8th is election day.
I have a meeting that night.
And I got a meeting early.
Well, I voted.
You haven't voted yet?
I'm looking at the polls all day.
I voted.
I haven't.
I'm just thinking about all the work that's gonna be required.
I'm waiting for them to throw them both out and put in somebody new.
I hope so. Maybe you're right, maybe you shouldn't have voted.
There is all that now there.
It's a write-in now, you can do it.
I'm gonna be on Tuesday.
President.
What about the night the special town meeting is gonna be, the 14th?
It's, here's what we've got, so.
I have personnel bill to work any now.
Oh, that's right, too.
So, today is what? 26th.
26th.
So a week from today is the 2nd.
I have.
Because CIPC.
I can make that one.
How about the 9th?
I can do that.
9th.
9th, we can do that.
Do that.
9th look good?
If I get up that day.
John?
Looks okay to me.
Get up.
You just stay here.
We're gonna be up all night, I'm sure, for the election.
Just stay here. Just stay here.
Okay.
We'll meet in the morning, how's that?
Bring me my coffee.
Bring you your coffee, there you go.
You wanna start earlier?
What time? The 9th?
The 9th. November 9th.
Okay, what time? What times are, how early can people?
2:30 in the morning, whether you finish, we can just continue.
Probably be in here counting votes.
Yeah, so they, when they finish that, we'll come in.
Bruce has got 2 votes already for president.
I had none of the above. I had to write it in.
That means we have to count it.
Exactly.
I have a feeling that's a lot.
What time is good for people?
At least you get it done. Just vote for Jill, come on.
Time's a meeting on the 9th.
What time are we gonna end at?
7:00.
What time?
What? 7 PM?
Unless somebody objects to it, yeah, 7 PM.
Earlier?
I'd like to see half hour earlier, if possible.
A little earlier. No?
6:30?
I can do it. Yep.
What is up, what are we gonna meet for? Will it take like 2 hours? Good?
I hope not. Just so that we can talk about what.
6:30?
Are we on for proceed?
6:30?
We on for 6:30?
Sounds all right to me.
So, we're gonna be talking about how we're gonna approach the FY18 budget?
Yes. And.
It would be helpful if we could get a little insight as far as what the select board did with departments, unless you have that information, Skip.
The problem is that if they don't do anything, they're supposed to do it, according to our book anyway. And if they don't do it, what happens is, the schools go along and just put in whatever they want every year, and that's 3/4 of our budget. And the problem is, it ties us up so that we're trying to scrimp and save every damn nickel and dime. And meanwhile, the schools, there's no restriction on them, because they're not getting that overall guidance. That's the issue.
Even when they get some guidance, they.
Okay, but at least if they get the guidance, they got something to shoot for.
Well, you gotta do.
And it sounds like our new superintendent's willing to listen.
Got a new board, you can ask them, you know. They may not aware of the importance, so.
Well, I think, Trevor's still on the.
He's on the school committee.
Yeah.
Right.
At least the elementary school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The elementary, right.
So, when do we start the process with the departments, and they hit?
Well, that's what we need to talk about. We need, I'm going to invite Carolyn to, hopefully, we can do something with her. She can come in, at least we can talk with her, and see if we can get this, so we're not getting into the
contest that we've gotten into the past couple of years where they, Carolyn sends a memo and saying, we're going to give you the budgets in February.
Yeah.
So
that's absolutely wrong.
Yeah, we need to avoid that. So.
So we're just going to develop a game plan.
So at least maybe we can get on the same.
I think a lot of the departments have their budgets made up by December. And if they do, there's no reason why we can't get them.
You should probably ask your son for his budget for the next 5 years.
Got it. Probably got it.
I thought there was some, like last year, I remember hearing that budgets were going to be developed by the end of November, so they could be decided to look at in December.
Mm-hmm. We get them in February.
Well, we didn't get them until February.
Right.
But that was for this year, that they were going to speed the process up.
But that administrator is no longer
here. But the administrator is no longer here. And
he was the one forcing it.
Okay.
And I don't know if the chair of the select board has issued anything to the departments or exactly what. That's what I'm wondering. So yeah, we as a board member.
There's a letter or something that went out. I didn't see it.
Okay. They did for the capital improvement planning. They sent it out.
Your letter is due. All your capital stuff is due by December. Right?
Yeah, that's due, but
right,
but nobody enforces it. Or
no, that's what I mean. I guess that's what I'm getting at, is that we should know all the capital improvements before we
get
the budget. Right, yeah.
At the next meeting, would you talk about the special capital stabilization fund at the next meeting?
Let me talk about it.
Explain how it's going
to
work.
You're trying to
I don't know anything about it other than it was on the special town meeting warrants.
Oh, I know, too. I had the same question.
What's the name of the present stabilization fund?
We'll have one.
Stabilization fund.
Right. Or just a stabilization fund, not capital stabilization.
Yeah, does it have a particular name?
No, we don't have.
Maybe a clarification.
One stabilization fund, and there's no capital.
Right. The capital stabilization, as I understand it, we put money into it. The question is when. And that would be what you had to spend the next budget year. Now, maybe that's not the way it works, but that was...
That hasn't happened in the past 2 years
since I've been on the committee.
No funding of that in the past 2 years.
Oh, no. But that's what the article on capital stabilization is
supposed to do.
Right.
Supposed to do.
The funding amount or set up the fund?
That sets it up, and we can put the amount in there.
Suggest out of free cash so much money is in it.
So why isn't there a name on the stabilization fund that we have?
There is. Stabilization.
General stabilization.
It's a general stabilization?
Yeah.
But they want to have a separate one for capital?
1.5 million? General stabilization?
1.2, I think. 1.2. It was 2.1 or something, but we took $1 million out of it to do the garage. So it's down about 1.1, 1.2.
So what would you like CIPC to do?
Give a briefing.
No, really.
I thought Doug was working with you on that.
Oh, you thought we did? No. Nope. He's been, since I got involved with the town, he's been a real advocate of doing that.
Yeah, he has. This is coming from Doug.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I suppose if you didn't like it, you could say, I don't like it. Go away. We don't want it. But Carol,
it might not be a bad idea. We need to...
I don't know whether you'll have time at the meeting. What's your meeting next week?
Two-thirds of the capital stabilization fund.
Stabilization.
I'd rather wait until we get all the requests. I'm sorry.
We're not going to put anything in now. This is really going forward.
Capital expenditures. General fund.
The question is, do we want one? I think that's what
I'm talking about. We can always have one and have zero in it. Then it's there if we need it. We can fund it.
If we want to fund it,
it'll be there.
I guess the thought was something like at the end of the budgeting process, and we go to town meeting, and we end up doing whatever we do at town meeting, and we end up with say, $500,000 left in free cash, we could then, put $250,000 or whatever the number is into the capital stabilization. That would cover the capital costs for the next year.
I think part of it was, you know, just some of the meetings I had watched over the time was the general feeling is we're waiting till the last minute to fund everything.
Mm-hmm.
And sewer system is a good example. The school roof, the garage, waiting till the last minute. This building's going to need a new roof. And all of a sudden, we're bombed with these million-dollar bonds. And when we have nothing, we're barely enough to cover architect's fees for half of these.
But if we don't have enough, if we don't have enough to cover these things now, how are we going to have enough to put into this fund?
Well, I don't care if it's only $10,000. It's $10,000 more than you've had previously, you know. And that's been the problem is you know, everybody's been looking at everything at this point.
Well, I guess, you know, if you think about it, and maybe 250 is not the number you want to use, but if you've got a five-year plan out there, and I guess, you know, you more or less have a pretty fair idea of what next year looks like. Not complete, but. And at the end of the, you know, say last April, if we had set this up and put in that amount or a little bit more, then you'd know what you had to work with.
I think we should wait. The CIPC and Finance Committee should work together and wait and see what the numbers look like when the budgeting process is done.
Yeah. I mean, we can talk about it.
The vote for this is just to set it up. It is not the point.
Well, oh, right, right.
There is an article.
That doesn't. They don't.
There was an article to fund it.
A separate one. Right. There was one article to set it up and then another article to fund it. So there's two separate articles.
Yeah.
So you don't have to, you're not voting to throw money into it at the same time. You're saying,
but we're sitting on $1.5 million in free cash. Do we have enough money to fund
something?
Yeah. Something, right. And I see it as a little bit of a forced savings plan, which this town hasn't been doing.
Yes.
And I think it could be beneficial and spend, maybe.
Well, at least we've got a little bit of time to talk about it
mm-hmm.
before town meetings pops up.
A special town meeting you're talking about or the annual?
Yes. No, they're going to do a special town meeting.
Right. Then they got to go to CIPC with it for the funding of it.
One would think so. Well, no, because we're not appropriating.
Yeah, they are. They just discussed it tonight. They're appropriating probably in between $850,000 and $1 million for that building.
For what building?
No.
We're talking about the stabilization fund. I am at the moment.
Oh, okay. I got you.
And that's got to go to a 2.5 override, as far as I'm concerned.
What's that?
The
funding, building the building.
For example, the library, they're talking about, you know, you talk about debt exclusion. Who goes and gets, since I'm new to this, who goes and to the lender? Who finds a lender? Who negotiates with
town,
the lender?
Town treasurer.
Town treasurer.
No.
Treasurer. Yeah, it's treasurer, but in this case, they're the same. Right. Yeah.
So I heard a word today that I never had heard before from a slightly relative to the bridge. They went and did a debt, to pay for the improvements to Stillwater Bridge. Something to do with our budget from last year. Do you hear the word?
No.
No.
Was it from the reserve fund?
No. No, they...
Not that
they didn't have. No, I know.
Didn't they vote to use free cash?
No. They said that they checked with DOR, and they were able to. We have to ask Alan. I'm sorry, I wish I remembered. But it was something I hadn't heard before. I looked in the manual in this book, and it was not described.
Yeah.
So
that one I missed.
It was like a budget override of some sort. The budget.
You're authorized to expend in addition to your appropriated money for an emergency.
Emergency, that's what it was.
Right.
So it's an emergency funded appropriation, mm-hmm. and you go up a certain amount
deficit
over
spending.
Your
deficit spending.
Deficit spending.
Yeah.
Okay. So we can deficit spend without our approval.
We can deficit spend without DOR's approval.
They can deficit spend the selectmen.
The selectmen can. They don't have to come to the finance committee.
No, that's a good question. They might. I think they probably do.
I think it'd be great to get our concurrence, but
I think they need
they do have the authority, the selectmen alone, to deficit spend.
Okay.
Like they have that authority for sand and ice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They can get the salt and sand. fund.
Okay.
They can deficit spend by state law.
Right.
And beyond that, it's up to the selectmen to determine any others.
Yeah, because the only one I've seen that exception is for snow.
Yeah, that's the only one, but they can deficit spend
for an emergency.
For an emergency.
But no, DOR gave them the
I think DOR gave them the
authorization.
They requested it. They said
last Thursday, they, you know, when this came up, I guess on Wednesday, by Thursday, they had talked to the DOR.
Right now, if they're only talking about $600, they could have cash.
Well, that's what I was thinking.
It's kind of like, well, we can vote that afterwards. They can spend it, and then we can vote to take out free cash to cover the deficit.
Have any of you read some of that mass municipal modernization bill? There is some stuff that pertains to this.
Yeah.
Revolving funds closing out to the general fund, and not being transferred. The snow and ice, they don't have to go through the finance committee anymore.
I haven't read that.
No.
Somebody's got to appropriate.
The selectmen can.
Town meeting has to.
On the deficit.
I haven't read the.
On the deficit.
Right.
On the deficit.
Well, on the deficit, they spend the money. Actually, the selectmen don't get involved. It, you know, the your former job and the Department of Revenue, and it comes off the recap sheet.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. But it's in the past. It's supposed to have gone through the finance committee anyway, without having to go through an appropriation. What I'm saying is, they take it out the finance committee end, where it's directly on the selectmen.
They have a budget of $80,000, right, maybe a little bit more.
Yeah, 80,
but they can overspend that.
Right.
And the department, I don't even think the selectmen need to approve it. The department head can spend it, unless the selectmen tell you can't spend it without our authorization. And then at the end of the year, if it's not paid for,
they just make a corrected entry.
Make an entry, which means really it goes
to the, right on top of
the assessors and the accountant, town accountant, along with the DOR, work out the arrangements.
If they've already got approval from DOR to do it.
Well, it's state law, and we voted.
Yeah, that statute, they don't have to apply for it then. So
it's, yeah, it's not anything that's being, you know, done surreptitiously.
Oh, no, it never was.
There are plenty of other things I get concerned about.
Thank you.
Are we all set?
Motion we adjourn.
Moved, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We actually.